Hi, welcome to the third session on theory of computation. In this video lecture, we'll discuss about the big picture of theory of computation. In the last video lecture, I told if a problem cannot be solved by Turing machine, then the same problem cannot be solved by the modern computers as well. You might be wondering what is the relation between Turing machine and the modern computers. I think this lecture will give you an answer for that. So any modern computer can be represented by this two blocks. One is the computational power, which is the central processing unit. The other is the memory, because all our modern computers are based on von Neumann store program concept. That means that your data, instruction, everything will be stored in the memory. CPU will read the instruction and data, process them and store the result back to the memory. So this is the simplified model of our modern computer. For the sake of convenience, we will split this memory into input memory, output memory, program memory and temporary memory. This input memory is going to hold the input data. The program memory will have the instruction. We will use the temporary memory to evaluate the instructions on the input data and store temporary results or intermediate results. And once the final computation is carried out, we will write the result in the output memory. So for example, we will consider evaluating the function f of x is equal to x cube. So the instruction for evaluating this function is like this. We first evaluate x square, which is x into x, and store the result in z. And we compute f of x, which is x cube, as x squared, which is z into x. So this is our program memory. And this is the instruction that we have written into it. Now let's consider a sample input x is equal to 2. That means that I wanted to evaluate f of x is equal to x cube for the value x is equal to 2. That means that we are trying to compute 2 cube. So let's see how we use the intermediate memory. We execute the instruction z is equal to x squared, that is x into x, and substitute the value for x as 2, and we compute 2 into 2, which is equal to 4, and store it in z. And then we compute f of x, which is z into 2, which is 4 into 2 equal to 8. And f of x is the output that we require. So we will write this output into the output memory. This is how a modern computer works. We'll consider now how this model computer can be modeled as automata. What we are going to do is that we are going to combine the CPU and the program memory together and make it as a single block called automata. So, and the input memory, output memory will be as usual. We will have this temporary memory separately, and we will change the model of the temporary memory to obtain different computational model. So it is very similar to the modern computer design that we have. The CPU and program memory together now is considered as the automata or the machine. We have the input memory, and the result of the automata will be written to the output memory. We have the temporary memory separately. We will vary the model of the temporary memory to obtain different models. For example, with finite automata, we do not have any temporary memory. That means that I do not have any memory to evaluate intermediate results. That means that with finite automata, I cannot do much of the computation. So it is a very simple computational model. Suppose if we model the temporary memory as a stack, we get a pushdown automata. You should have learnt what is stack in data structures. Stack works on the principle of last in, first out. That means that whatever element that you have pushed at the end, that is what is the element that will be coming out when you pop from the stack. Only after processing that element, you can go to the next element in the stack. So you have very restricted access to the elements stored in the temporary memory. And the capacity of the pushdown automata is high compared to finite automata because there is no temporary memory at all here. Here we have some access to temporary memory. Okay, so the computational power is better compared to the finite automata. The last model is the Turing machine, wherein we do not have any restriction to the temporary memory. So we have random access memory like what we have in our modern computer. Our primary memory is random access memory. I can access any element anywhere in the memory. So such model is the Turing machine. That is why I said if a problem cannot be solved using Turing machine, that means that it cannot be solved with modern computers as well. So we'll see this models. So with finite automata, I do not have temporary memory. So we have very little computation for finite automata. Example is a vending machine. For example, you can see the vending machine now in monorail stations where it issues ticket. You have very restricted type of input, like you can insert only 10 rupees note or a 50 rupees note, something like that, and you can get the tickets. You cannot randomly enter any note like 100 or 2000 rupee note and you cannot expect the machine to operate. Another simple vending machine that everybody might have seen as a weighing machine in railway stations. You can insert 1 rupee or 2 rupee and it will weigh you and print the weight on a card and give it to you back. Okay, so this is a very simple vending machine. One more vending machine that was very popular is coin phones. I don't know whether you have used it. You can insert 1 rupee coin and make a phone call. So such type of simple function based machines can be modeled with finite automata. Next is push down automata. So the temporary memory is now modeled as a stack. So you can push the elements and pop the elements. Now the capacity of the pushdown automata is high compared to the finite automata. That means that it can decide whether a given statement belongs to a particular programming language or not. That is, given some statement, say for example, int x semicolon, it can say, the pushdown automata can say whether this statement belongs to the C language or not, or C++ or not. It is able to decide whether you have followed the right syntax in that particular programming language. So it is actually a membership problem. You are giving a statement in the high level program and it is, the pushdown automata is going to say whether the statement actually follows the syntax, the rules of the language. So if you have followed the rule, it is a member of that particular language, otherwise no. So it is again a membership problem. Okay, and it can solve the membership problem of all programming languages. Given a statement, programming statement, it can say whether it is part of that programming language or not. The next computation model is the Turing machine, where we do not have any restriction over the temporary memory. And the temporary memory we have modeled as random access memory. So this is the highest computation power that we know till today. So we can write any algorithm in any high level language and we can use the Turing machine to solve that problem. And remember, even there are functions which Turing machines cannot solve. So to compare the computing power of different machines that we have seen, the finite automata is the least computing power machine. Compared to that, pushdown automata has better computation power and the highest computation power is the Turing machine. I have taken all these slides from Rensselaer Polytechnic Institute. In the next video lecture, we will discuss about the mathematical foundation that is required to understand the concepts in theory of computation, and then we will get into the actual course. Thank you for watching this lecture.